So you've seen a lot of what we've shown you just before I start with this conversation, but what you don't know is how this entire show came about. I came here. This is the first time we're doing contrarian offset. I came here to a hotel in Delhi, just off Delhi, in fact, for an event where a product was being launched. But as we got talking, a whole contrarian came out of it. How is that? Well, I'm about to show you. Let's start off with question number one. You've come to India and you've created quite a sensation. But a lot of people would say that you've created a brand out of almost nothing in this country. Rewind the chapter a little bit and nobody would know even how to pronounce your name, which is a problem even now. People go with Xiaomi. How many ways have you had people pronounce your product and your brand?
Many different ways. But what's cool is that those who know how to pronounce it properly feel like they're part of a special club.
Also, it's good bragging rights because you know, the way I do it is I let people keep on pronouncing it wrong. And the whole conversation carries on and on and on till I finally say it at the end saying, by the way, all four of you don't even know how to pronounce the name. So that gives you a feel good that, you know, at least you know how to pronounce it.
And you're in the special club, of course.
Exactly. But having created this, do you believe that this is a sustainable way of creating a brand in a country like India? Because India is very conventional in terms of the brands that they actually go with, honestly and very dedicatedly. But your brand has been completely exceptional. People didn't know about it. A lot of hype and buzz, a lot of headline news, lot of creation created this brand. Is that sustainable in a country like India?
So I actually think that the way we go about creating a brand is potentially more sustainable than the traditional way. You know, in the traditional way, a brand is created through, you know, advertising, through media, through visual stimulation, and so on and so forth. You become attached to something that you see or hear about without necessarily really thinking about it, really internalizing, choosing to be part of it. The way we build a brand is about community. It's about fans. It's about a certain type of passion that starts with the geeks, of course, that I actually think is much more profound.
But in India, a lot of people would say it's not the geeks and the nerds that made the brand for you. It was the way you presented the brand, because it's a lot about the headlines that you made in other countries. Sold out in so many seconds, so many people went in, the website completely got inundated. We don't have enough product, we have too much demand. It got created by the very idea of herd instinct. Is that the right way that you would be able to sustain the brand here? Because suppose those shocking headlines don't come anymore for you, you become a brand that is selling in huge numbers, but you're not selling out in 3 seconds, then can you still sustain the brand?
I think so, and it's an evolutionary process. You know, we start with the shocking news, with the buzz that you've mentioned about this sort of high desirability of the product that perhaps is very hard to get. That may be how we initially got some traction, admittedly, but over time, it's the fact that people really like these products, the fact that they want to buy the next version, the fact that they like it enough to recommend it to their relative or to their friend, that creates this word of mouth that sustains us. And if you look at other markets where we've been for longer, today what keeps us at top of mind for these fans, as we call them, is not the shocking headlines. They are still there, by the way. But it's a really profound and legitimate loyalty that people have because they like the product. They enjoy the experience.
One of the biggest claims that your company, Xiaomi, has always been made, you've always said it, and you said it right now, that we're all about community building. Now, your community in India is constantly saying that the way you're selling the phone is great for you as a company to build a brand, those shocking headlines, great marketing, incredible hype and buzz, but it's not necessarily a good customer experience for those that are buying it. You know, that almost panic that they're going through, it opened only for 3 seconds, 4 seconds, it's gone, damn, I didn't get it. That couldn't be good for both the human body as well as the heart, for sure, right? But you continue to still sell in flash sales rather than a more sustainable way where I can get a better buying experience and then a better product which I use.
Yeah, so we've suffered right up there with our fans, you know, when people couldn't get a phone after 4 seconds.
But is that true? I mean, it's great for you that you get these headlines and you're always sold out. Where's the suffering?
It's great the first couple weeks because it gives us the headlines, it gives us excitement that, you know, we're doing something right because people want our product. But after a while, it's not fun anymore because people complain. And you know, some people literally call our call center and they're crying because they can't get it and because someone wanted to get it for their girlfriend or for their sister or for whatever it might be. So most importantly, that experience has to improve. And it has been. Over the last few weeks, if you wanted to get a Mi device here in India, you actually could, right? So it was possible. Having said that, I think we have to experiment with new models. I think we have to evolve and adapt and try new things out. Maybe there's a new booking model that we could come up with. And we also need to start exploring how to do the offline. How do we enter the offline? So that's something that we're beginning to think about.
You say you also want to talk about the offline part of it, but your entire business model and the aggressive pricing is built on the online model. So if you were to take this offline, which is to some people would be the other 93% of the country, some people would say 88%, but that's a huge number of people that have never ever seen your phones, never touched your phones, and never took a buying decision because they don't buy online. If you go into retailer distribution and the retail margins, the price of a brick and mortar, the rentals that are paid, the staff, the salespeople, you've got to be able to change or will have to change your pricing model.
So we are going to keep the price the same, not only because that's important for our business, but because that's an expectation that we've already created. There's a few things that we can do. You know, we can experiment with a hybrid model where perhaps the reservation happens online and the fulfillment happens offline in a manner that doesn't require multiple levels. Another approach is to consider the fact that the products that we're selling are not limited to the smartphones themselves, which we sell pretty much at cost or near cost at all times, and we might keep it that way. But we also sell accessories. That's just one potential approach that we think exists for trying the offline market. It's quite ways off for us. It's really early to try that right now. But that's just one example of where I think it could work.
And the cool part about doing this talk with you is that every time I ask you a question, a part of your answer is exactly my next question. So again, I'm going to take the one thing that you said. You said that you sell the product almost at cost or maybe even below or just above, somewhere. I mean, it's somewhere there, right? Now, to most companies, that in itself would be the most uncomfortable thing to talk about. But in an interview with me before, you've already said it, and you're saying it again today. If your entire thought process is that the product, the phone in itself, is only a way to get into a customer's house so that they can now give you more business with accessories and your software updates and, you know, your themes and all the other things that you have, first and foremost, is this a proper thought-out strategy, or did it happen once and you've taken after it? And can you sustain this? Because then there could be many clones that would be doing the same thing.
When you think about, when you look at our products, and you look at our portfolio, we have a very small number of products that we can sell for a long time. We just discontinued a product called Mi 2, which we sold for over 2 years. And we only stopped manufacturing it because some of the parts were no longer available. So we couldn't make it anymore because there was still demand for it. When you look at a product like this and you look at the cost of all the components over time, right, it's actually possible to make a little bit of money if you sell it for a long time, right? So that is a very acceptable, viable business to have. You know, it's how Amazon operates, by the way. They run on very, very low margins, and many other companies do, successfully, right? If you attach to that a premium services strategy where we make a little bit of money from software or from services, for example, perhaps accessories on top of that, hardware and software accessories, we can actually have a phenomenal business.
So I'm going to wrap it up with two quick fire questions. So the first one is, I hear that you're going international, but you're going to go for more markets, like, for instance, Brazil before the US. Is that just because it's hometown, so you want to make sure that you get everything that you're famous for and all over everywhere else and take it back to hometown and show off in front of family saying, we created this? Or is that a business model that you've thought out because it just makes more sense?
Brazil is actually the next most logical market.
Okay. Why is that?
Because of its sheer size. Okay. It's a very, very large market. It's booming. The mobile internet is booming in Brazil. And products in Brazil are so expensive. There's no good reason why it should cost so much more in Brazil to buy a smartphone than it costs in India or in the US or in China.
While you've gone through a controversy here in India with the whole Indian Air Force thing, and you've buried it, so we won't talk too much about it, but it does bring up a very interesting perspective, and that is that because you'll always have the China syndrome, which is you'll always be stamped as a Chinese company looking towards expanding to the rest of the world, you will constantly go through these things. Is that something you'll be able to do something about?
Yeah, I think you're right. And I don't think this is the first or last controversy that we'll see here in India. You know, to us and to me in particular, with the experience I have working in software companies, when it comes to privacy, when it comes to your relationship with users as it pertains to their personal data, you just have to build trust. And building trust takes forever, right? It's like being in a relationship. And we are and will continue to be in a relationship with our fans. And we will show to them with gestures over time that they can and should trust us.
You know, some insurmountable problems have been surmounted by you. So congratulations, and we'd love to see what you do in the future.
Many thanks. And it's a real honor to be here.
Thank you.